Welcome. Thanks for being here. Appreciate the fact that you're willing to take a few minutes and learn the facts of a very complex case. And I know it's been a long time. We'll talk about that in a few moments. But I wanted to basically set a couple ground rules for our discussion at this point. I understand that, or I expect that you're going to have a number of questions. I ask that we hold those until appropriate time so I can kind of go through the material and then we can try and address the questions at the end. I want you to know that we are, right now, we've already made the document portion of the investigative file open to the public. It has gone live on our website about 5 minutes ago. And in addition to that, there are photographs and audio recordings. But we did not have the bandwidth to put them on our website. And so they are public records subject to disclosure, and upon request, we'll certainly assist you and others in reviewing what's there. But we simply didn't have the technological capability of putting the photographs and the audio and video recordings online. I have to say that I believe that transparency is paramount, particularly in tragic events of this nature. And that's why I wanted to sit around and have a conversation with you. We have some documents that we're giving you. One of them is a copy of the declination letter, which also went out this morning to the Adams County Prosecuting Attorney. And it is an explanation of what our decision is. And so I commend that to your reading. We also have given a fact sheet which identifies not all of the facts, but relevant facts in terms of the decision making. And there are a couple of other documents. There's a press release that we've given you, and also a couple of other discussion points, ethical requirements for prosecutors, and a statute called justifiable homicide by officer. We're going to be referring to those in a few minutes. So I also wanted to make certain that we understood that this briefing is on the record. you're free to use it as you choose. But if we get to a sensitive area that perhaps we're not able to talk about, we'll call a timeout. We'll discuss how to proceed. But at this point, everything is on the record. I want to talk, first of all, that this was a tragic event that personally outside the confines of my role as a prosecutor. It's a member of our community who was killed tragically on November 1st. And there's nothing that we can do here today that is going to change the outcome of that. And it's unfortunate, it was tragic, and it occurred in a very short time span in a very tumultuous way. I can't think of anything that would be more devastating or tragic. So please recognize that my condolences go to the Yantis family and to their friends and supporters, but also to the Adams County community and to council. It's been a tragic event in their community. It's caused tremendous distress among the community members. And I have the greatest sympathy for all of the people involved here because this has been sincerely a tragic event. I hope that in the time to come that there can be some healing in that community and that the citizens can gain some confidence in their local government and law enforcement officials. That's my most sincere hope. I wanted to also thank Idaho State Police for a very thorough investigation. They did applied their expertise. They went the extra mile upon our request. I cannot thank them enough for the effort that they put forward and the professionalism that they showed. I also want to thank my own staff, particularly Paul Panther, the Criminal Division Chief, Jason Spillman, who is here. He's the Chief of the Prosecution Division. Mike Steen, who is also here, is our Chief Investigator in the Criminal Division, and my executive staff as well. They've spent a lot of time and effort to try to make certain that we did this properly. I wanted to talk briefly about the scope of my review, because it's my sense that perhaps some of your questions and some of the community's questions will deal with issues that I didn't consider, and in fact weren't appropriate for me to consider, and by statute I was not responsible to consider. So the scope of our review is very limited and narrow. I focused solely on the facts, the evidence, the statements that occurred before and during and immediately after the shooting. And within those parameters, it was my duty to determine whether the deputies involved in this matter, whether we could show beyond a reasonable doubt that they committed a crime. It's equally important to understand what the review did not consider. Excuse me. This includes such things, things we did not consider includes matters of law enforcement policy, public policy, and those kinds of things, such as the appropriateness of firearms that were in the possession of the deputies during the shooting, the use of body cameras. You will note as you review the information that there is no body camera videos. This made our job much more difficult. But it's not appropriate for me to weigh in on whether that was proper policy or not proper policy. The fact of the matter is, we were stuck with the fact that no such video exists, and we had to work from that perspective. We didn't address whether it's an appropriate policy to call ranchers to the highway when an animal has been injured, or any other civil or policy or administrative matter. We are focused solely on one issue, and that is there proof beyond a reasonable doubt that a crime was committed and that these officers committed that crime? Other questions, those kind of policy questions, will be dealt with in other forums and at other times. So let's kind of cut to the chase a little bit and talk about what we have decided. After reviewing the facts, the evidence, the witness statements, and applying them to the relevant criminal statutes, I have concluded that no criminal charges will be filed against Deputies Brian Wood and Cody Rowland. That decision comes as a close of my role in this investigative matter. We have spelled out the details and analysis in our declination letter, and again, I commend that to your reading. This was a complex case, and I hope you'll understand that when you begin to examine the reports and statements and the evidence that we had to review. There are a couple of points that I wanted to talk about as we discuss this. First of all, this case presented significant ethical and legal challenges. So if I could just refer for a moment to the ethical requirements for a prosecutor. The Idaho Rules of Professional Conduct, Rule 3.8, says the prosecutor in a criminal case shall refrain from prosecuting a charge that the prosecutor knows is not supported by probable cause. The comment section to that rule also provides that it is the responsibility of the prosecutor as a minister of justice not to be simply that of an advocate, but to make certain that guilt is decided upon the basis of sufficient evidence. So that's the obligation that we have, is to make certain that before we file a criminal charge, that we believe there is sufficient evidence to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. And the American Bar Association standard specifically provides that as well. A prosecutor should not institute, cause to be instituted, or permit the continued pendency of criminal charges in the absence of sufficient admissible evidence to support a conviction. A conviction in this matter has to be supported by evidence that is sufficient to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. So if we do not have evidence to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt, we're ethically bound not to file criminal charges. So that means in short terms is that we can file criminal charges if and only if we believe we have sufficient evidence to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. In addition to the law that applies here, I refer you to Idaho Code Section 18-4011, justifiable homicide by an officer. And that language provides that homicide is justifiable when committed by public officers, and specifically, if you look at subsection 2, when reasonably necessary in the discharge of any other legal duty, and use of deadly force shall not be justified in overcoming actual resistance unless the officer has probable cause to believe that the resistance poses a threat of death or serious physical injury to the officer or to other persons. This statute specifically addresses some of the matters within this case. We considered a number of other criminal statutes in homicide, including murder, voluntary and involuntary manslaughter, but the facts didn't measure up to the requirements of those statutes. The justifiable homicide by officer statutes dictates that the ultimate question in this case will be whether the use of force, of deadly force, was reasonably necessary. That means the burden of proof would require the state to prove beyond a reasonable doubt that the homicide was not justifiable. I want you to think for a moment about this case, however, and we'll explain the facts, but think of this. You're sitting at your dinner table. You receive a phone call from law enforcement officers. You drive to the end of your driveway, and 5 minutes later, you're shot dead. Something has gone tragically wrong. But my responsibility as the prosecuting authority in this case is not to determine what has gone tragically wrong. It is to do something different. It is to examine whether there is proof sufficient or evidence sufficient to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. It's a different function. I am not saying that the actions by the deputies were justifiable, nor am I saying that they were not justifiable. We are saying one thing, and that is, it is our firm professional belief that we do not have sufficient evidence in this case to prove guilt beyond a reasonable doubt. And as a result of that, our conclusion is that we will not be filing criminal charges in accordance with our ethical and legal responsibilities. As I stated earlier, this is a complex case. And piecing together exactly what happened during that five-minute window when deputies called Mr. Yantis from his home to the time that the fatal shots were fired was a significant challenge due to the conflicting statements made by the various witnesses. And those conflicting statements create a sufficient doubt to prevent a jury from holding anyone criminally liable for this unfortunate and catastrophic incident. The declination letter explores the various versions of the evidence in detail, but I want to highlight some of those discrepancies. So in order to do that, I've got to address this drawing. So excuse me for standing in here, but I think this is important. And by the way, I've asked my folks who have the greatest command of these details to stop me and correct me at any moment when I have not spoken correctly. We've spent a lot of time trying to do this, but the details here are quite varied. I'm going to try and give you a sense of where everyone was, but recognize that I can only give you approximations and that the witness statements are so varied here that anything I tell you, there's probably a statement by one of the witnesses or another that will contradict or conflict with what I'm telling you. That's part of the problem here. So this depicts Highway 95 just to the north of Council, and it depicts the area where the incident occurred, and it is the driveway of that belongs to the Yantis. This is a representation of their driveway as it enters Highway 95. Sort of slightly across the road is a small turnout. When this incident occurred, just to the south of this scene was the accident scene where individuals ran into the bull who was out of the pasture. They were terribly injured and had to be life-flighted because of their injuries. The bull was still alive and was causing a very serious problem with the emergency workers who were extracting those victims and needed to be dispatched. And so there was a call, I think, at 7:10. At 7:10 that this bull was out. There was a call at 7:22 to Mr. Yantis, who was at the dinner table with his wife and his nephew, and told that he needed to come and handle this bull. They got on a four-wheeler and drove down their driveway to the end of their driveway. Mr. Yantis was at dinner with his nephew, Rowdy Paradis. Mr. Paradis also drove a skid steer, small, it has hydraulic front. The purpose of that was to allow lighting to the scene and to then remove the carcass of the bull once it was dispatched. I can only give you essentially approximations of where everything is. This represents the four-wheeler. This represents the skid steer. There was a patrol vehicle which was stopped in the entrance to the Yantis driveway. There was another vehicle, a pickup, I believe, correct?
Sir.
Pickup, and that was a...
it was a white Dodge that may have belonged to one of the first responders.
And so it was parked approximately like that on the that would be the east side of the highway in a southerly direction. The bull had wandered through this scene, but when the the officers indicated that the bull was near the front of the pickup with its head pointing in a northerly direction. One of the other things we need to know here is that when this accident occurred, there was traffic that was stopped to the north of this accident scene. The officers allowed traffic, it's a major highway, there's no route around this, it's a very narrow place on the highway, they allowed traffic to move to the south. The exception were there were a number of, there was some large trucks that could not turn around, and they were too big to go through the scene. So you had trucks up here, you had accident scene here with emergency personnel and traffic that had moved through the scene. So when Mr. Yantis was called to the scene, they came on the four-wheeler, he retrieved his rifle. He was noticed working the action and or loading the rifle. Again, various discussions of what that was. He approached the bull.
Lawrence, excuse me.
Yes,
sir. Can I interrupt?
Yes, please.
I just want to clarify one thing with the bull. And the concern that it was causing for the emergency personnel was it wasn't happening down here by the accident scene. The bull had wandered off to the side of the Yantis driveway after the officers had provided some assistance down there. They were helping the traffic control, and we're looking for the bull because they were concerned about it. It was injured from the accident. It was making some aggressive motions. It was upset. While the Yantis family was coming down to the scene, Officer Wood fired several shots into the bull. So those shots occurred before the bull comes to the spot where the Attorney General was talking about. And that is believed to have happened. That series of shots is believed to happen while the Yantis family is arriving on scene or en route.
As clearly as we can tell, Officer Wood was in about this location at the time those shots were fired.
Correct.
To the bull.
As you can tell, it's complicated to try and get all the pieces here. The bull then went over and with its feet underneath it, was lying down near the front wheel well of this pickup, facing north. Mr. Yantis retrieved his weapon, walked toward the bull, and as he passed Officer Wood, he made some statement. It's nearly as we can quote, "Get that piece of shit away from my cow or something, or my bull," or something to that effect. I don't know exactly the words, but it was something of that nature. Officer Wood, Deputy Wood, had moved from this location to somewhere over here, as nearly as we can tell, and Officer Roland was somewhere in this vicinity. Mrs. Yantis was somewhere in the vicinity of the ATV, and Mr. Paradis was somewhere in the neighborhood of this skid steer. Mr. Yantis moved around the bull and then prepared to shoot the bull probably from the front, or because the bull was facing north, and he was going to shoot the bull from the front. Officers Wood and Roland became concerned because the shot would have been moving in the direction of the accident scene to the south. Now that, I'll have to tell you, there's various views of all of the people involved here as to what happened, but I'm trying to give you some sense of the best we can do. At that point, there was, according to some witnesses, a confrontation. May have been physical, may not have been physical. Again, the witnesses vary. Between Officer Wood and Mr. Yantis. You'll have to read the witness statements because they vary about whether there was a physical touching, whether he was jerked, whether Mr. Yantis pushed Officer Wood, but there was some kind of interaction.
And there's also, to clarify that point, there is contradiction about whether or not it was Officer Wood or Officer Roland that actually interacted with Mr. Yantis at that time. Not only contradiction about whether there was any touching, but whether which officer it was.
And in fact, we can talk about that a little bit. In an initial interview with Mrs. Yantis, she indicated it was the officer, the best description would have been Officer Wood. But in a subsequent interview, it was Officer Roland that she said had the interaction with him. Again, that's part of the issue here, is the challenges of the various stories. So at that moment, then, according to some of the witnesses, the officers, Mr. Yantis, he was either moved across the highway, and he took his gun and moved it across the body of Officer Wood and or toward Officer Roland, and At least one of the witnesses indicated he made a aggressive move with his gun. At that point, the officers fired and Mr. Yantis fired. We do not know who fired initially. It could have been anyone could have started first. We honestly don't know the answer to that question. It could have been simultaneously, but in any event, there were a number of shots fired. I think Mr. Yantis was hit 12 times. Came to rest in the highway in the southbound lane. During that time, Officer Roland said that he drew his pistol and he began to fire because he was concerned for his safety. Officer Wood said he was concerned for Officer Roland's safety. And the one thing we do know is that Mr. Yantis' rifle was fired. There was an empty brass in the chamber of the gun, and so there was a shot fired. Officer Roland had said, I'm hit, and actually Mrs. Yantis said she believed she heard Officer Roland say, I'm hit. Mrs. Yantis and Roland, and Mr. Paradis, from their perspective, didn't see or didn't indicate seeing the same kinds of moves that the officers reported seeing. So what I'm trying to explain to you is that there were four critical witnesses at this scene. Their statements don't coincide with each other, and sometimes they don't coincide with themselves. And so what we are left with from a prosecutorial perspective is that we have four witnesses who each have varied stories to tell. And the question is, does that add up to proof beyond a reasonable doubt? And the answer here is no, it doesn't. Now, is there other physical evidence? There's one other thing that I think you should know, and that there is a 20 caliber bullet that ends up in the middle of this scene. And we don't have an explanation as to why that bullet ended up there. We had that examined, and it was determined to be a 20 caliber round, which was the same caliber as Mr. Yantis. However, the experts could not tell us that it came from Mr. Yantis' gun. We have no way of understanding or knowing how that bullet ended up on the asphalt in the middle of this scene. Part of the issue that we have to deal with in terms of what happened here. Have I covered this sufficiently?
Spot on.
Yes, sir.
If I can, I'll take my seat again. A couple other things that I want to...
Maybe one thing I will clarify.
Please go ahead.
While you're making the switch. The positions with regard to where the officers are, it's like Lawrence said, that's an estimate, an approximation based upon assessment, but there is contradiction about where they're located. It is pretty clear that they are closer to Mr. Yantis and in a more superior position to observe what he's doing at the critical moments than Mrs. Yantis and Mr. Paradis. And then the other thing with regard to the bullet, it was not only tested for ballistics to see if it could be matched up with Mr. Yantis' gun, it contained some blood on it, so it was tested as well. Neither of the officers had any bleeding, so to determine whether or not it was Mr. Yantis' blood or possibly the bull's blood, it was tested, and it was Mr. Yantis' blood that was found on it. But that was not really unexpected, since there was quite a bit of blood on the scene.
There were two other witnesses, and they offered very little bits of information, some of which corresponded to some of the things that the officer said. For example, Mr. Paradis indicated that at the conclusion of the shooting that the officers had a celebratory moment. That is contradicted by other witnesses who say that they were very distraught. So just about every aspect of this case in which you have a statement by a witness, there's really a countervening statement by someone else. Mr. Paradis also indicated that Mr. Yantis had been drinking throughout the day and that his blood alcohol content was above the legal limit. There's nothing illegal about that in terms of his being at his house and driving down his driveway. But whether that plays or doesn't play into the events here, again, all we can deal with are the relevant facts as they are, as we're able to find them. So, after thoroughly reviewing all the materials, the facts, the lab tests, and the witness statements, I have determined that the evidence in this case is insufficient to support a conviction beyond a reasonable doubt of Deputies Wood or Roland. I wanted to talk about a couple of other matters, and we acknowledge there's been criticism from the media, from the community about the length of this process. And I guess all of us wish that matters could happen much faster, but that isn't the way our system is built. So that we understand, we received an appointment as special prosecutors in this case shortly after November 1st when this incident occurred. And we received a variety of documents from Idaho State Police throughout their investigation. We actually asked them at one point to send us, to stop sending us it in piecemeal, to send it to us when they had the matter ready. We received the final documents from ISP on about March 10th. I think they issued a press release on that occasion to let the folks know that it was in our hand. However, we did not receive some elements of this case until June 7th or 8th. Was it June 8th? June 8th. There were two elements that came in on June 7th or 8th. One of them was the ballistics testing, and the other is that we had asked for a ISP to do an additional interview of Officer Roland, and so that report came in, I think, on June 8th.
No, I think the interview was the 7th.
Interview was the 7th, and
that, the... That could be backwards, though.
Okay. June 7th and 8th, we received the report of the subsequent interview and the ballistics report. So if you consider the fact that we received this on June 8th as the final day of the final pieces of information, we're making our announcement today. We've had this matter really less than 2 months, about 7 weeks, 7.5 weeks. And by anyone's standards, that's a pretty good rapid rate of response. By the way, this file contains 5,300 pages of documents, about 830 photographs, and more than 30 hours of audio and video recordings. That's a sizable amount of information to be able to review and to assimilate in a very short time period. In addition, on June 13th, we had asked Idaho State Police to do a reconstruction of this scene, which they did for us in Meridian at a location similar to this. And the reason why we didn't do the reconstruction at Council is that it presented too much of a hazard. We would have had to have stopped traffic on a major highway, and that puts not only the individuals reviewing the scene at risk, but it also puts motorists at risk. So we reconstructed this scene in Meridian and walked through the entirety of the events and the various witness statements. And then we drove that same day to Council and went to the actual scene. I was present at all of this. And we went to the actual scene at the end of the Yantis driveway on Highway 95. And quite frankly, dodging traffic, went through the events that occurred there, so that we had a full and complete picture of what had happened and the restrictive nature of that scene. What I mean by that is a very narrow place. It is a lot of traffic coming through there, and so we had a full picture of what was going on.
I may have misheard this, but I think the photograph number is slightly over 590. Right, yeah.
Okay. Okay, so something less, slightly less than 600 photographs that we have in that file. So, by any measure, that's an extensive file with the responsibility to go through. And from day one, I told my staff to take their time, to be deliberate, because, as I've said before, we only get one chance to do this right. And it's important that we know and understand the complexity of this case. They did what I asked them to do, and I appreciate that. I really felt that it was inappropriate to set any arbitrary deadlines or to discuss any aspect of this case publicly, because that is our ethical responsibility. So with that, I certainly would open us to any questions that you may have. And again, I would commend your reading the fact sheet and the declination letter, because I think it will help you understand. So, what questions do you have?
You may have actually said this when you were speaking. I may have missed it, but did you have an idea of where the witnesses were at the time that the Yantis' jug was discharged?
The best I can do for you is this. There's one element I forgot. You notice that there are two bulls here. I mean, first of all, say the bull was facing north, but during the events, the bull had moved and then ultimately came to rest in about that position, okay? So this scene changes. So giving you positions, these are not static positions. So Mrs. Yantis was in the vicinity of the ATV. Mr. Paradis was in the vicinity of the skid steer. Deputy Wood was in the vicinity of the bull and this pickup. Officer Roland was somewhere to the north of the skid steer, but most likely in the southbound lane of Highway 95. Again, these are approximations, and recognize this is was a live scene where things were changing, so I can't give you a specific spot and say that person was there for the entire time, because that didn't happen.
And again, those positions that approximation is contradicted by certain witnesses that will, Mrs. Yantis will places Officer Roland closer to her than Officer Wood. That's, you know, we don't have a distance in those statements, but that's the sort of gray type of information that we were working with. Mm-hmm. And the locations of the officers contradict themselves somewhat. So we can't answer that. And that's the type of information that a jury expects. And so that's part of the problem with this case.
So again, what I'm trying to tell you is that we can only give you approximations, and as he said, the witnesses contradict each other.
Do you have an exact location where the bullet was found, the 20 caliber bullet?
It is marked. I don't know if it's marked on this. On this chart or not, but when we were at the scene, they showed us the location where that.
It's gonna be one of the dots next to.
It was one of the. Yeah, it was one of these dots. I'm trying to see number 5, round metal, number 6, brass colored piece of metal, number 7, two brass colored pieces of metal, number 2.
Yes.
Broken stock.
No, that's actually a scar.
I honestly can't tell you which one.
And so the question was, there was a section of asphalt that was removed from the highway. Mm-hmm. That asphalt was actually a scar from a bullet ricochet that created a divot in the asphalt, and the Idaho State Police cut that section out to test that scar for bullet traces.
No,
does that answer your question?
I needed you to answer the question.
Okay.
You said there weren't, there wasn't dash cam or body cam videos, but I missed if you said that were the officers equipped with, did they have access to that equipment?
Our understanding is that they both were wearing body cam equipment. They were asked why they weren't running, actually not by us, but by Idaho State Police. One of them said that, and I'm not going to be able to get at all who has what, but you can read that in the documentation, that one was on standby and the memory was full, and the other one said that his, because this was a traffic accident and was not a critical event, that his body cam was not operating. He didn't turn it on. And so, you know, from our perspective, that explains why they were shut off, but we certainly would have been to our advantage to have body cam video here, but we just don't have it.
And were there cars equipped with dash cameras?
I don't know whether the cars were.
Yeah, I believe so.
And were those something that they would have had to flip on manually, or were they something that was
automatically? I can't answer that question. I can tell you that there was not recording from any of the dash cams that were available.
But I also recognize here was one of the patrol vehicles. This was not a patrol vehicle. This was a
Civilian truck.
A civilian truck of some sort. I guess I can't speculate. I don't know whether it had a dash cam or not, but I would suspect it didn't, but I don't know. But you can see that with that scene, that if this was the patrol vehicle with a dash cam, it wouldn't be recording what was going on at that location. All I can tell you is that they weren't operating, but you can look at the scene yourself and make a determination.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Go ahead, Mike.
As far as the tone of the investigation, were the officers in Adams County, as far as the tone of the investigation, were the officers cooperative with the investigation?
Oh, yes, the officers were cooperative. I mean, they had counsel, which they're entitled to, but they were very cooperative. And in fact, they both, there was actually two different reconstructions of the scene. One was done by ISP with the officers where they walked through that. You actually can view that video. And then there was a second reconstruction of the scene when they did it for us. And you're most welcome to take a look at the video of those officers doing the original walkthrough.
With the, you said Jack Yantis was shot 12 times?
Mm-hmm.
So was that at the breakdown between each officer, with six from one, six from another, or do you know?
It's Officer Roland, there were, and you can, the information that you have is from what the spent shell casings are on the scene. There were 20 total spent shell casings. Four of those were from Officer Roland. Six, and Officer Roland never fired at the bull. It was only Officer Wood that fired at the bull. The other 16 spent shell casings were 223s. Which would have come from Officer Wood's rifle. There were 8 wounds to the bull, but only 6 of those are confirmed gunshot wounds. Another one was a glass wound, we think, from the impact of the car. Another one just from part of the necropsy when they were letting air out. And so, best we can tell you, 16 shots total were fired by Officer Wood. Officer Roland fired 4.
And we can account for 18 of the 20 shots, correct?
Yeah.
There's two of them that we cannot account for.
And then was there a shot by Yantis?
And a shot by Yantis.
Correct. And that, you found the bullet?
What we found was an empty round in the chamber, meaning the gun had been fired. But there is a bullet in the scene of the same caliber, but we cannot confirm that came from his rifle. We're not saying that it did come from his rifle because we don't have evidence to say that it came from his rifle. Okay?
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes sense.
And I apologize if I missed this, but did Officer Deputy Roland's bullet strike Mr. Yantis?
Yes.
So both deputies?
Both officers shot Mr. Yantis.
And were you able to determine excuse me, the time span of, I mean, it sounds like it happened in a pretty short time span, the shooting with Yantis. Were you able to determine if he, at any point he was incapacitated and whether there was a span of time before shots continued or did the shots stop once he was incapacitated?
What we know is this, that the original radio call the phone call occurred at 7:22, that the radio call for all units that the owner was down was at 7:27. So this entire event took place in 5 minutes. In terms of the number of rounds fired, we can tell you what those number of rounds fired were. The officers are trained to shoot until the threat ceases. So all we can tell you is this happened very rapidly, and that's the best we can do.
To clarify, the call to Jack to come shoot his bull came at 7:22.
And the call, the radio call from the officers came at 7:27, saying that he had been shot. So from the time he was called till the time of the radio to the dispatch was 5 minutes. As I said, this is a catastrophic 5 minutes. You receive a telephone call at your dinner table, you drive to the end of your driveway, and 5 minutes later you're dead. Something went wrong here. But my specific responsibility is to say, is there proof beyond a reasonable doubt? And given my ethical duties, given the statutes, given the facts, and the fact that there is not clarity in the facts, I do not believe we can prove guilty on the reason of that.
To kind of get at what she's asking, was there any witness descriptions of one burst of bullets and then a pause and then another burst of bullets? Or like, what was the description of how this went down?
The description was it was very rapid firing of bullets. There was no pause.
You have certain witnesses that hear separate volleys of shots. And you'll have to go through those materials to see the different accounts of that. Witnesses will attempt to identify, I heard, the first shot was louder than the other shots. Witnesses will say they all sounded the same to me. Some will say there was a pause. There's pretty much a consistency with the witnesses that heard it between the volleys that would have been Officer Wood firing at the bull, and then the volleys with the air action between the officers.
And I was going to say that there was at least some shooting which occurred when Officer Wood shot the bull, and then there was some time period before there was the interchange between the officers and Mr. Yantis. So that there is a time period.
You said with the four eyewitnesses there were conflicting reports. Were the deputies' accounts consistent, or were their accounts also conflicting between the two of them?
Their accounts did have some consistency, but their accounts also had some conflicts.
What were some of the conflicts?
One of the conflicts you're going to have to look at.
Probably the biggest conflict with the officer's testimony or their statements is whether or not there was actually any contact between Officer Wood and Jack Yantis. When Jack Yantis is pointed towards the bull, has his rifle pointed there, and the officers have the concern, they both will state that Officer Wood went to intervene. Officer Wood, his account is that he reached in, but there was no touching between he and Jack Yantis, that Mr. Yantis had swung the rifle at that point. Officer Rowland's account is that as a result of Officer Wood going towards Mr. Yantis pushed Officer Wood. That's the biggest discrepancy.
And at the same time, then Mrs. Yantis indicates that there was some kind of physical interaction that the officer grabbed or pushed or pulled Mr. Yantis, and Mr. Paradis also indicates, I believe he also indicates there was some sort of grabbing or pulling.
But his indication is that it was Officer Rowland that was interacting with Jack Yantis. And I think you'll find that we tried to Clinton, I mean, that's a very important piece of the interaction here. We tried to put those four main witness statements for you to outline what they said about that specific moment in time.
And that's in the declination letter, pretty clearly spelled out.
So what other questions do you have?
You said you looked at justifiable homicide and murder manslaughter and those types of charges. Were there any other, I mean, and I don't even know if there's like such a thing as like a criminal negligence or any other sort of categories of charges?
Homicide statute has two main categories, murder and manslaughter. Murder has two parts, first degree, second degree. First degree murder is the unlawful killing of a human being with malice aforethought. Second degree murder is the unlawful killing of a human being without malice. That doesn't, neither of those categories seem to fit. In the homicide statute, there's also then the second element, which is, or the second category, which is manslaughter. Manslaughter comes in three kinds: voluntary, involuntary, and vehicular. Vehicular doesn't apply here. Voluntary manslaughter.
Upon a sudden quarrel or heat of passion. Right. And then I think what you're looking for is the involuntary,
correct,
which is, you know, that is the reckless, careless, negligent type. So it's obviously a lower standard. The point is that the justifiable homicide statute, that defense that's available to the officers, that we have the burden of proving that that's not a defense beyond reasonable doubt, that's applicable to all those.
So the potential here was involuntary manslaughter, but you have then actually two more statutes that come into play. One of them is the homicide by an officer, which we've talked about, but there's an additional statute, which is homicide by, it's essentially self-defense statute. And so those are affirmative defenses that are applicable to all the homicide statutes. And particularly in this case is the homicide by officer statute, which has direct applicability. So you understand that's the legal framework that we had to work with. Fair enough?
Yes.
So if you took out that framework, it was just four gentlemen out on the street with an involuntary manslaughter charge being in play?
It may or may not be, because remember, there isn't just the homicide by officers as an affirmative defense. There's the additional self-defense mechanism. So if this was four people, and again, complete speculation at this point because it has no bearing on what happened.
Yes,
so, but that's the question you've asked.
Yep.
So four individuals standing there. If a person would feel threatened or that some other person was threatened, they would be justified in using the force necessary to stop that threat. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Fair enough?
Yeah.
Okay. So, other questions?
When all these events occurred, was it dark out there? Was it lit up by the lights from the skidster?
What I can tell you is that the phone call came in, it's, as I've said, 722, 727. Can you tell me what the light?
It was dark. The skid steer was brought down, not just to remove the carcass, but also the way it's angled is to provide light onto the steer. The steer is black. And it was so it was dark enough to where they had to position that tractor to illuminate the steer. So if that kind of explains what the lighting was. It's hard for us to say we weren't out there, but what we have indications, it was dark.
Just because I anticipated that question, I will tell you, I got online and said, what was sunset in Council, Idaho on November 1st, 2015? Some accounts it was 5:30, and other accounts it was about 6:30. I can't account for the difference. But so we're now talking an hour after sunset, approximately, an hour to 2 hours, depending on. And I'm not giving you that as a fact. I just anticipated the question, so I looked at it myself. I invite you to go find out what the facts are, okay?
Is there photos from that night out there that could give us an idea of what this scene looked like in the packet?
Yes. Not in your packet, but we had those available for inspection.
The photographs again, as I said, we can't put those online because we just didn't have the technical capability of doing that. They're public records, subject to disclosure. If you want to look at them, we invite you to come have an inspection as allowed by the Public Records Act.
So we've got another briefing in a few minutes. You guys have a couple more questions, and then we'll probably try to wrap it up.
Does the decision not to file criminal charges in any way foreclose or affect the possibility of civil?
No, it in no way implicates the civil case. The civil case is handled on a different standard, in a different forum, and we are not making any comment whatsoever about the nature of the civil claims that may or may not be made.
Have you, there's also a federal investigation going on, is that still?
That is correct.
And have you given the U.S. Attorney's Office or the FBI or whoever's invested in that your findings?
Yes, they are aware of our findings, and I had a discussion with them. They also, you would probably find that they've issued a press release this morning at 9 o'clock, in which they declined. I'm not speaking for them. Mm-hmm. I invite you to go find out. But I was aware of what their findings were. They did their investigation. They were parallel investigations, but completely separate. We did communicate throughout the time, because that's appropriate for law enforcement to do. But they made their decision all on their own. We made our decision all on our own. And their standard is a little bit different. It's a federal law about whether there was a civil rights violation. I'm aware that they were preparing to issue a press release this morning indicating that they were not going to file criminal charges. But again, I invite you to learn that from them, not from me.
Okay. And one more question.
Sure.
Okay. There's been a lot of, but obviously it's been a highly emotional case for a lot of people.